Hello everyone, welcome to Spark Study. In this video, we study about the transfer function. What is the utilization of transfer function in the plant or in control systems? And some relative component we'll study, just like poles, zeros, dominant pole, and number of things. So let us start with the definition of transfer function. As you know, the transfer function is the ratio of output to the input of a system or of a plant. That means if you there is a plant and you are giving some input and you are getting some output with control mechanism. So when you convert this input and output into mathematical form and take the Laplace transform of the output and divide it by Laplace transform of the input, so we'll get a transfer function. Okay. So think about like this: transfer function T of S is equal to some n by n, whatever, some denominator by some numerator. So it is very much clear that the transfer function must be a fractional quantity. So when you make the numerator to zero, that means the transfer function becomes zero. Yes or no? Yes. And when you make the denominator is zero, then also the transfer function becomes infinite. So you are not able to control the system, right? Here you can see that whenever you make the numerator zero, the transfer function zero, and when you make the denominator zero, the transfer function becomes infinite. So the concept here will get some the frequency which make the transfer function infinite, or the frequency or the value of frequency which make the transfer function zero, those are called the poles and zero respectively. Okay, we'll study about these things. So what is the definition? Say the transfer function of a linear time invariant system is defined as the ratio of Laplace transform of output function to the input or deriving function. Okay, so the output is the response function while the input is the deriving function with zero initial condition, right? So let us study about the poles and zero. I told you the transfer function is equal to some numerator divided by some denominator. Here what they have actually taken, let's say this A of S is my output and B of S is my input. So instead of this, you can also take like C of S divided by R of S, okay? And instead of G of S, you can write the transfer function T of S. Okay, so this transfer function T of S is equal to C of S divided by R of S, which equivalently gives this kind of function. Here S is the frequency. We can write these things in Laplace. This is the Laplace form, and you also can write it in time domain form. So this is the frequency response form. Okay, so let's say we have just an input and we just give a function G of S, okay, and output is my C of S, okay, input is my R of S. I told you, what is the transfer function? If you write this mathematically, you can write C of S is equal to the multiplication of R of S into G of S, okay, no doubt. And we know that transfer function is the Laplace transform of output to the input. So what is the output? That implies my output is C of S, and if I divide the R of S, so what I get? I just get G of S. Okay? So likewise, that is why they have given in this form G of S. Okay? But the thing is, this is a very simple system. I have just a single gain block. Okay? So if it is a multiple system, this is a open loop system, if I have some feedback loop or any feed forward path, any kind of things, then this transfer function can be of different category. Okay, so in that case, what I found out is, what is a pole? So if I take this transfer function, okay, and if I make the denominator part to zero, what is that? S minus SA into S minus SB into S minus S M dot 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 number something is equal to 0. So I take the multiplication of each thing is equal to 0 so that my GFS becomes something divided by 0. Okay, that is equal to infinite. Yes or no? So here I need to find the value of S. S is the frequency. Okay, here S is the frequency. And what happens if I equate this thing to 0? Either this is equal to 0 or this is 0 or this is 0. So any kind of thing, A, B, lots of things, S minus C, S minus D, numbers of components are there. I just make only some n numbers of poles. So what can I get? If I equate these to 0, so what I get? S is equal to SA. Similarly, if I equate this to 0, I will get S is equal to SB. And when I equate this to 0, what I get? S is equal to SN. So I have found out this frequency value. Okay? So SA, SB and SC. So when the frequency becomes SA, remember this thing, when the frequency of this transfer function denominator becomes SA, the transfer function denominator becomes 0 and the transfer function becomes infinite. So it becomes unstable. Okay? That means either any value S is equal to SA or S is equal to SB or S is equal to SM, if I find this value and apply in this denominator, the denominator becomes 0 because S, when I make S is equal to SA, so SA minus SA, this becomes 0 now. So once this becomes 0, so multiplication of all the terms also becomes 0 and that is you. We can find g of s is equal to 0, transfer function is equal to 1 by 0, that is infinite. Okay, so what is that? That means if the frequency of my transfer function denominator is equal to, or if the frequency of my transfer function is equal to the poles of transfer function, then the output will be infinite. I have no control with the output. Okay, so whenever the denominator terms become 0, that times the number of frequency I am getting, all are called poles. Okay? And poles are represented by cross symbol. Whenever you represent poles in a plot, then you represent the poles by some cross symbol. Okay? This represent poles. Okay, poles means cross. Similarly, if I equate this numerator to 0, so what I found? I found S is equal to S1, S is equal to S2 and S is equal to Sn. Okay, that means n numbers of 0. So when I equate these to 0, I get this S value as this frequency. So whenever my frequency becomes S1 or S2 or Sn, in that time my numerator becomes 0 and I found G of S is equal to 0. So ultimately whatever my input will be, output reaches to 0. Okay? So that is nothing but the poles. That is nothing but the zeros. That means 0 actually make the transfer function go to 0. And poles make the transfer function to go to infinite, and the zeros are represented by circle ZERO, 0. Okay, so this is all about the poles and zeros of a transfer function. If someone asks you find the poles of a transfer function, just equate the denominator to 0 and find the S value. And if someone asks you to find out the 0, then equate the numerator to 0 and find out the zeros. Okay? Next, simple poles and simple zero. What is a simple pole and what is a simple zero. Let me write a transfer function, that is t of, okay, the transfer function, let me write it. Let me write t of s is nothing but s minus 1 into s minus 2 divided by s minus 3 and s plus 2. So let's say this is a transfer function. And what is the poles? To find the poles, I need to equate the denominator to 0. So what is that? S minus 3 into s plus 2 is equal to 0. So what I get, either s is equal to 3 or s is equal to minus 2. So these two values are my pole value. Okay. Similarly, if I equate my numerator to 0, what I get, s minus 1 into s minus 2, which is essentially becomes s is, if I equate to 0, I'll find s is equal to 1 and s is equal to 2. So this is nothing but my zeros. Okay. So if I plot these things in a plot, what I get, this is called pole zero plot. Okay. Remember, this is called pole zero plot, and the x axis is my real axis and y axis my imaginary axis. Okay, and here you can find 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4 and so on. But here it is called j omega axis. Okay, we will find 1j, 2j, 3j and so on, minus 1j, minus 2j, minus 3j, so on. So this is my imaginary axis and this is my real axis. If I found what the pole, pole is 3 and minus 2. The pole is 3 and minus 2. Okay, what is 3? 3 is here. So I put a cross here and minus 2 here, another cross. Okay, so I have found two distinct poles. One is real right side of the S plane. This plane is called S plane. Okay, S plane. Okay, so this is called my S plane. Okay, so what is my 0? 0 is s is equal to 1, s is equal to 2. So here I am getting 0, where 0 is at 1 and is at 2. So I found two distinct pole and two distinct 0. So it is very much clear that if no poles or zero are overlapping with each other, then it is called the simple poles. So simple poles. Okay. So these poles and zeros are called simple pole or zero. Okay. This is called simple pole or simple zero. What is that? I have taught you a simple pole and simple zero. Then let's say, what is multiple poles and multiple zero. Okay? So, just like things, I have written the transfer function P of S is equal to some, I wrote S minus 1 into S minus 2 divided by, let's say, S square minus 4. Okay, so let's say this is my transfer function. Okay, so what I find, if I equate these to 0, divide to 0, I'll find the 0. Zeros are s is equal to 1 and zeros are s is equal to 1 and s is equal to 2. What about the poles? found s square is equal to 4, if a equal to 0, and s is equal to plus minus 2. Okay? So, one pole is at plus 2, another pole is at minus 2. So, you can see, here plus 2, 1, 4, 1, 0, and plus 2, 1 pole is overlapping. Is that no? But in some case also, I can find like this, transfer function is equal to s minus 1 into s minus 2 divided by s minus 4 the whole square. So this kind of things also I am finding. So in this case, what is the 0? S minus 4 the square is equal to 0. This is my pole function. And what I found is s minus 4 into s minus 4 is equal to 0. And I found s is equal to 4 for this and also 4 for this. That means I found two different poles at same place overlapping with each other. That means if I draw the pole zero plot, let's say I am drawing the pole zero plot here. Okay, let's say I am drawing the pole zero plot here. What I found, one pole here, one pole has s is equal to 4, another pole is also at s is equal to 4. So two poles are overlapping together, two poles overlaps. So this is called multipole poles. And if two zero becomes overlapping with each other, that is called multipole zero. So the poles and zero may not be in real axis. It can be up here, it can be here, anywhere in the S plane. So this total plane is called S plane. S stands for frequency plane, and we can write S is equal to J omega. Okay? S is equal to J omega. What is that? S is equal to J omega. Here omega is, what is the omega? Omega is the angular frequency. Frequency, and it is the unit of omega is radian per second. And if you convert this omega into hertz, I mean to frequency f, so omega is nothing but 2 pi f. Okay, omega is equal to 2 pi f. So if I want to find this omega, I mean if I want to convert radian per second into the hertz, what you do? The hertz unit is for frequency f, and get f is equal to omega divided by 2 pi hertz. Hz hertz. Okay? And if you take the reciprocal of frequency, that is 1 by f, this is called t or tau, and this is called time period. Okay, so this is called time period. Fine. Next, I'll study some proper and improper and rational transfer function. Okay, what is a proper transfer function? Just hold on. I told you the transfer function are in numerator and denominator formula. Numerator and denominator form. So T of S is equal to some n divided by m. Okay? So, what is the proper, when you go for fraction, what is the proper fraction? The proper fraction when numerator is less than denominator, this is called proper fraction. Okay, similar thing is applied here. Whenever the order of denominator is greater than the order of numerator, then the transfer function is called proper transfer function. What is improper? When numerator order is greater than denominator order, then it is called improper. Okay, but for our convenience, for any kind of mathematical things, we should use a rational transfer function. That means the order of numerator should be equal to order of denominator. Okay, or the order of numerator polynomial is equal to number of denominator polynomial. So in that case, when you think, sir, s minus 1 divided by s minus 1 into s minus 2, if you do this, s power is 1 here, so this is order 1, and here s into s, that is s square. If you multiply this, I will get quadratic equation, and here s power becomes 2, so order is 2. Okay, so this is a proper transfer function, because order of numerator is less than order of denominator. So this is a proper transfer function. That means from this transfer function, what do we get? You can see here it is s minus 1, here also s minus 1 into s minus 2. The poles, if I equate these to 0, then I will find s minus 1 is equal to 0 and s minus 2 is equal to 0. So I will get s is equal to 1 and s is equal to 2. I am getting 2 poles, and 0, I am getting a single 0, that is s is equal to 1. Okay, so 2 numbers of poles and 1 number of 0. So obviously this is a proper transfer function. But whenever the system becomes stable, this should be a rational one. So if you go for the pole 0 plot, if I plot it, I will get plot 1 and 2, one pole here 1, one pole here 2. Let's say it's cross, so that you can make a thing. Like minus 1, I am getting 1, 0 and minus 1. Minus 1, 1 and 2. Okay? So, it is, now you can see that, if you make denominator to 0, I am getting 2 poles, whereas I have only 1 0. So this becomes a proper one. To make a rational one, my numerator degree should be equal to denominator degree. That means I should have 2 0 and 1, 2 0 and 2 poles. In that case, 1 pole, so 1 0 is at infinite. So now, let's say what is a minimum phase transfer function and non-minimum phase transfer function. Okay, so this minimum phase and non-minimum phase are important thing to define the transfer function. Okay, so whenever you see in this thing, let's say in G1, this is here, I just write, okay, you can see here, G of S. Now when I replace S by J omega, and I wrote G of J omega is equal to 1 plus J omega T1, 1 plus J omega T2. Okay, I just replace this one. And if I want to find out the zeros, here 0 becomes, what is that? If I make this to 0, can you say what is the 0? Right, you can see here. 1 plus S plus T1. So that S plus T1 and ST1 is equal to minus 1 and S is equal to minus 1 by T1. So this is my 0 for this. And similarly here, J omega becomes minus 1 by T1 and omega is equal to, if you make the J to this side, minus 1 by J T1 or 1 by T1 J. Okay? So when J go to numerator, it becomes minus, and minus minus is plus. Okay. So here it is very much clear that if in the transfer function or in the S plane, you have many numbers of poles and many numbers of zeros. Here it is clear that if you equate this denominator to zero, obviously you get a negative pole. So here pole become negative for this transfer function because this is positive. So when take the left side becomes negative, and for g1 of j omega, my poles are negative. Also my zero becomes negative because all are positive. So this is, let's say, t1 and this is t2. Okay. So what is a minimum phase? Minimum phase means whenever all of my poles and all of my zeros of a particular transfer function lies in the left side of S plane. Okay. So when all poles, take a note, when all poles and all zeros lie in the left half, this is my imaginary axis, and left half is this side, left half of imaginary plane, then it is called as what? It is called as minimum phase transfer function. So what are the methods of analysis? When you are going to solve the transfer function, there are two different methods. One method is the transfer function approach, which is mathematical and easy to solve, and one is straight variable approach. That will be taught in the last half of the second half of the syllabus. Then first, in this session we will study about the transfer function approach only, and the benefit or advantage of transfer function approach is it is a simple mathematical algebraic equations, and it gives poles and zeros of the system directly, because when you equate the denominator to zero, then you get poles. When you equate the numerator to zero, then you get zeros. The stability of the system can be determined easily. The system becomes stable when all the poles are left half of the S plane. Okay, that is called stability. The output of the system of any input can be determined easily. Okay, so whatever you give the input, the output can be understood easily. That will be solved in the next class, that you will understand then. Okay, so what is a OLTF and a CLTF? The short form indicates OLTF means open loop transfer function. So this is my transfer function. Okay, this is my C of S, this is my R of S, and this is nothing but my G of S. So this is an open loop, that means there is no feedback. Okay, what is that? If there is no feedback, what can I do? I just write transfer function is equal to C of S divided by R of S, which is nothing but my Z of S. Okay, so this is my transfer function, T of S is equal to Z of S. Okay, but when I found a transfer function is, when I found a block diagram is somewhat look like this, this is Z of S and this is R of S, where this is C of S, and I have a feedback element which is nothing but H of S, and it is given feedback here, and this must be a negative feedback. Okay, in this case, this is called a closed loop control system. So as it is a negative feedback according to the formula, and we know very well that the transfer function T of S is equal to Z of S divided by 1 plus G of S into H of S. Okay, so this is my transfer function of CLTF, this is my OLTF, and this is my CLTF, closed loop transfer function. If you see these two diagrams carefully, we have found out here there is no feedback, and here we have a feedback, and it is H of S. This might take different value, different algebraic value. Okay, the closed loop transfer function feedback might take different value, so that the value can range from minus infinite to plus infinite. So different range of value h of s there. So that if you try to make this h of s is nothing but 1, what is that? When my h of s becomes 1, this system is called unity feedback. Unity feedback. Okay, the system is called unity feedback transfer function. Okay, so let us think like whenever you are having a unity feedback, the OLTF transfer function becomes G of S and CLTF transfer function becomes what? When it is unity feedback, this H of S becomes 1. So I just erase this H of S because H of S, G of S into 1 is equal to G of S. So this is nothing but G of S divided by 1 plus G of S. Yes or no? A simple formula. Okay? So the formula what I am going to derive, that is a shortcut method, and you should remember this method for any kind of exams. And it is clear that the method is applicable only to unity feedback. Okay? Only to unity feedback system. So in the OLTF, if I make into fractional form, I will write G of S divided by 1. Here, it is already in fractional form. So, here numerator is nothing but G of S and denominator is 1. Yes or no? Denominator is 1. Here numerator is G of S and denominator is 1 plus G of S. Okay. So let's say I want to find the CLTF. I want to find the closed loop transfer function from open loop transfer function. Let's say open loop is given. And it was asking ki the closed loop is a unity feedback system, find the closed loop transfer function. So what you do, I just write the numerator divided by 1 plus numerator. Is there anything wrong? And this is from OLTF. So numerator of OLTF divided by 1 plus numerator of OLTA gives CLTF, yes or no? So this is numerator G of S. G of S divided by 1 plus G of S. This is nothing but a CLTF. Yes or no? Similarly, if you want to find the, so what I found is, OLTF from CLTF is equal to numerator divided by 1 plus numerator of the OLTF. This is CLTF. Okay. CLTF from OLTF. Okay. Because my OLTF numerator is G of S and denominator is 1. So if you do like this and get the things. Okay, so transfer function of CLTF is nothing but G of S divided by 1 plus G of S into H of S, and H of S is unit feedback, so it is like this. And for OLTF, this one, and this is for CLTF, and for open loop transfer function, just G of S. Okay, this thing. So how to convert this thing, and how to convert the OLTF, the CLTF to OLTF? Okay, you just take the numerator divided by denominator minus numerator of CLTF. These are two important formula. Just remember how to get this. Numerator is, here you can see, closed loop numerator is G of S and denominator is 1 plus g of s, and I'm getting numerator g of s. So this minus plus cancel. This is then I'm getting g of s only, which is nothing but the open loop transfer function. Okay, so this is all about how to convert. Remember this formula, how to convert OLTF into CLTF and how to convert CLTF into OLTF. So there are two alternative forms of expressing transfer function. The transfer function can be expressed in frequency constant form or time constant form. What I already told you, the transfer function can be of denominator by numerator, and it can be written as S term. And S is essentially j omega, that is 2 pi f j. So that is called frequency. So if in terms of S is there, it is called frequency constant form. And in case of if I convert the S into time domain T form, the basic form is 1 plus TS. Here S minus S1, S minus S2. So when you find it, 1 plus TS form, this is called time constant form. Similarly, if you equate the numerator to 0, you will get the zeros. If you get equate to denominator to 0, then you get the poles. Similarly, here also, if you equate the numerator to 0, you will get zeros. And if you equate denominator to 0, you will get the poles. But here it is frequency form, here it is time form. When you convert these to each other, then also you get the same value.